You know what kind of a woman this is. Kind of a woman this is.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We ask the Holy Spirit to come and fill the hearts of the faithful, to kindle within us the fire of his love, that we may be recreated, and he may renew the face of the earth through us who seek to live in the divine will and receive the third fiat of sanctification. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
My question to you, Father, or, you know, I want you to expound on this. When Pope Francis said, all religions are paths to God, because I'm thinking about the Muslims who, they're very offended when we call their Allah.
Not all of them.
Father. Well, many of them, they don't call him Father, right? And certainly not Jesus, as me and the Father are one. So I guess I am inviting you to, if you can expound on
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I said this 1,000 times, and I'll say it 1,000 in the first time. You should listen to my previous talks. I address this over and over again. Let me ask you a question, Janine. Did you choose where you would be born? What country? It's impossible.
Okay.
Did you choose in what family you would have been born?
No.
Did you choose in what religion they would raise you? No.
Nope.
That's three no's. Is that your fault? That's four no's.
Yeah.
Suppose you were born in a Muslim family. Now, is it wrong to obey the religion your parents raised you in as a toddler because you respect your parents? No, there's nothing wrong with that.
Mm-hmm.
You're a child. You do what you're told. There's a virtue in that. Why? Because Jesus says, well, God the Father tells Moses, obey your father and your mother. It's a commandment from the Christian world. So what's wrong with a Muslim or a Jew or a Hindu doing that? There is no fault in that. That's the first point I wish to make. Second, once the individual attains the age of reason, they begin to think, but they still need guidance. Now, normally in religions, they indoctrinate you in that religion, meaning the parents do to the child, due to no fault of the child. And the child will most definitely be influenced in its core in that religion because they're doing a virtuous thing by obeying the parents. As the child matures through infancy, adolescence, adulthood, it now attains the age of independence. In most countries, it's 18, 19, where they're on their own, they make their decisions, the parents are no longer their guardians. Now they can start to make their own choices. But up until this point, they've been indoctrinated. Now, God sees all this. He doesn't hold them responsible for all this obedience training. It's in that context that all people are children of God. Okay? Now, are there truths in all these religions? Absolutely. Even Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger said this. Just go back to read his documents. He said, even every heresy has a truth. Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger said that. Every heresy contains a truth. So much more, every religion contains a truth. But does that mean that all religions contain all truth? Of course not. The Pope never said that. They're pathways to the truth, meaning they contain some truth, but they have to be refined. Again, the individuals in that faith are not all responsible equally for that creed because they were raised in that. That's how God sees us. We just see the end result. They're Muslim, they're Jews, they're not in the full faith. That's not the way God sees them. We have to put on the lenses of Christ. And that's why Pope John Paul II, Pope Benedict XVI, Pope Francis went to Assisi in this ecumenical gathering where there was all the where there were all these religions, not to syncretize and eviscerate the Catholic and bring it down to their level and say, oh, we're all the same. The popes never said that. They said their pathways, meaning they're leading up to. And this is something that we have to cultivate. Consider, for example, Canon 844. Now, I know this addresses just Christians, but it brings within its sweep Protestants, Catholics, and Orthodox in one family. Canon 844 of the Code of Canon Law states that a Catholic minister, under certain conditions, can give the sacraments of confession, communion, and anointing of the sick to Protestants, to Orthodox, provided they meet certain conditions. Pope Ratzinger, well, Cardinal Ratzinger, before he was coronated pontiff, gave communion publicly in St. Peter's Square during the funeral of John Paul II to the Protestant founder of the Taizé community, Roger Schultz, before he was murdered in public. He gave it to a Protestant. So God looks at our history first, and then he looks at our condition in the present. If someone approaches, say, a person and says, here's the saving truth of Christ, naturally there may be a little bit of resistance because they were raised with a different mentality. And this is where patience and charity come in. If they're approached the right way, we may win them over. And this happens. You know, there's a community called Jews for Christ. They were Jews once, they still keep their Jewish heritage, but they embrace Christ as the Messiah. They still celebrate Hanukkah, they still do their things, because they're still part of the Jewish community and family as well. But I don't know if I answered your question, but
Yes, thank you. That's very good. Good.
okay, you're welcome. I wish to start off with a quick question that Dr. Michael sent, and that is on the upcoming Jubilee year. Now that we're in December, we're in Advent officially as of today, a year of preparation for the Lord, and this month, Pope Francis, on the eve of Christmas at 7 p.m., December 24th, will open up the portal of St. Peter Basilica, thereby initiating the year of indulgence devoted to the virtue of hope. And toward the end of November, there will also be the canonization of two young Italian boys, one who died at the age of 15, Acutis, and the other at the age of 24. And Pier Giorgio Frassati. And they both lived exemplary Christian virtues, holy lives, and they will both be canonized by Pope Francis at the end of. Well, let me make sure I get the dates right, because November's here and gone. Let me double check. I think it's November next year. Let me just pull it up here. Let's see. They will be beatified. I'm sorry, canonized. Oh, it'll be April of next year. Okay. During the Jubilee year. Carlo Acutis and Pier Giorgio Frassati. Let's see. April 27th, Sunday, 2025. They will both be canonized. Okay. That will be the same. Let me double check. I think that's when we both celebrate Easter, that is East and West, April 20th. So this will be just a week later. The week, it will be Divine Mercy Sunday. How ironic is that? The date in which Luisa was born, the day in which Luisa was born, Domenica Inalbis. Giorgio Frassati was a third order Dominican like Luisa. And he was the son of the editor of a famous Italian newspaper called La Stampa. And he liked to go on the high mountains and ice caps, you know, up there in the mountain. I went up the second highest mountain twice in all of Europe. And it's Monte Rosa. The highest mountain in Europe is Mont Blanc in Geneva. The second highest mountain is Monte Rosa in Italy. I went up there twice. And the second time I took my dad, he was afraid of heights. I found that out quick. once you went up on the little gondola, oh no, the funicula. Yeah, beautiful experience. You have to pace yourself when you're walking up where you hit the snow caps, because then the air gets thin and you lose your breath real quick. So while initially the impulse is to walk fast because it's a slow, easy ascend, you will quickly run out of oxygen. So if you're an experienced climber, you start off, you have to discipline yourself to start off slow, even if it's easy. That's the key to walking at a distance when you're going uphill. And it's beautiful up there because everything's rarefied, the air, the animals, the birds, etc. The other saint who died from leukemia, rampant leukemia, Carlo Acutis, he was 15 years old only, but he was a very generous soul, pious, into media influencing computers, things like that, using it for God's glory, devoted to the Eucharist. And yeah, they both obtained two miracles, which is a great thing. So there's holiness, and the purpose of the Jubilee is for us to be reminded that despite all the evil in the world and the abuse of power of those who wield it over us, oftentimes taking away from us our Christian rights and freedoms, there is hope, as exemplified in these two young saints, younger than us. And therefore, God can raise up saints even in these end times of iniquity who live in the world. Okay. Also, I'd like to talk about the virtue of hope with respect to the servant of God, Luisa Piccarreta's writings, because Luisa was baptized. And in that moment, she, like us, when we were also baptized, received the three theological virtues of faith, hope, and love. Now, Pope Francis in 2015 inaugurated a jubilee. This is his second jubilee year. And the one for 2015 was for mercy. In fact, Mother Teresa of Calcutta, he canonized in that jubilee year of 2016. There were two other canonizations during jubilee years. One was that I recall, one was by Pope John Paul II in 2000 by Saint Faustina. Of St. Faustina. I was present for that in St. Peter's Square. And in 1950, by Pope Pius XII, who canonized, somebody canonized, and I don't recall it right now. It'll come to me, I suppose. Oh, Maria Goretti. Maria Goretti, Pope Pius XII canonized, sorry, during the Jubilee of 1950. So there will be another jubilee next this upcoming December, where two more saints will be canonized during that year as a sign of hope. And these three theological virtues that we receive at baptism are really the personification of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay? And as a result of the infusion of God through faith, hope, and love, the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit, original sin is expelled. This is known in theology as sanctifying and justifying grace. Sanctifying grace, which is a permanent habit infused in the soul at the moment of baptism as a result of faith, hope, and love entering within us, gives way to the expulsion of original sin. That's justifying grace, which makes us just in God's sight. Now, Jesus, with respect to these virtues, tells Louisa, she writes, while my soul was immersed in the immense sea of hope, my beloved Jesus came back and spoke to me about love, telling me faith, hope, and love give way to, sorry, faith and hope give way to love. And love unites the other two virtues in such a way that they become one while they remain three. Oh, my spouse, this is how the Trinity of the divine persons is concealed in the three theological virtues. And that is why I said that they are God personified, faith, hope, and love. They conceal the three divine persons, that is, the three theological virtues conceal the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, who definitively enter the soul at the moment of baptism, which can never be undone. It's an indelible character permanently impressed upon the soul, much like marriage or priesthood. Can't be unmarried or unordained, unbaptized. All right. Now, to talk a little bit about these virtues, one must understand that, as St. Paul articulates in his letter to the Corinthians, love is the greatest. And we will in the end be judged by love, because love is the crowning of all the virtues. All the virtues are perfected by means of moderation, except one, and that is love. Now, Thomas Aquinas makes a distinction between love and charity, often times used synonymously. Charity he expresses as love toward neighbor on a horizontal level, whereas that's charity, love toward neighbor. Love, on the other hand, is vertical toward God. So if we were to recall Jesus' words in Matthew's Gospel, who cites Deuteronomy, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is the Lord alone. Ye shall love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, mind, soul, and strength," vertical, "and thy neighbor as thyself," horizontal. Although they're oftentimes used synonymously, charity and love, there is that scholastic distinction, if you will. Hope, on the other hand, is the virtue that makes us look forward to, with desire, the reward for which we strive on earth. That is the beatific vision, the possession definitively of the gift of living in the divine will in its complete sense of the word. And the communion of saints, angels, and so forth. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about baptism, how it leads into man's attainment of hope, faith, and love, especially hope, because it's about the Jubilee year, right? The Jubilee year is focusing on hope. Now, baptism grants adoption, as Paul says, as potentiality, that is a seed. And in Greek, the word for seed is sperma, right? You know that from biology with a man and a woman. Its fertilization and flowering depend on the will and actions of the believer. So this flowering is progressively realized through faith and love. Now, there are certain early church fathers, doctors, even Eastern writers like Maximus the Confessor, who addresses this flowering through the exercise of faith and love. And love is the exemplification and embodiment of faith that encompasses the virtue of hope. It reconciles the broken unity of the three theological virtues in man as a result of original sin that we inherit, and heals man's will and restores unity to God's order in creation. So man's turning to God in faith and acting out that faith with hope helps restore the likeness he lost through the sin of Adam. Now, Pope Leo and the Council of Constantinople address this as well, so does Maximus the Confessor. When they speak of the Spirit, the third fiat, they don't use that expression, third fiat, they say the third person of the Trinity, through the outpouring of whose gifts help lead us to perfection. And of the three theological gifts given at baptism, faith, hope, and love, they become virtues after we attain the age of reason. They are gifts because they're freely given at baptism. Of faith, hope, and love, nothing is more truly godlike than divine love, nothing more mysterious, nothing more apt to raise up human beings to divinization. So hope prepares us for love. Love, Paul says, Of the three that remain in his letter to the Corinthians, faith, hope, and love, love is the greatest. Now, the theological debate revolves around Paul's use of the word remain, because Thomas says, Thomas Aquinas, faith and hope no longer remain when you die, just love does. Because faith is believing in things not seen. When you have the beatific vision, you don't need faith because you're seeing God, seeing, beholding the Trinity and the angels and so forth. And hope you no longer need because you attain that which you hope for. So Thomas says that faith and hope no longer remain, but Paul says they do. Who's right? It's a perspective response, sort of like looking at a picture. Depending upon the lighting cast thereupon, you will see different shadows or different hues. Certain light changes the color of the picture. Same thing with perspective in theology. If you approach something from with a certain context, it means one thing. But if you approach it from another context, it means another. It doesn't change the substance of the meaning. The doctrine doesn't change, but the perspective may. Sort of like discipline in the church that changes with different generations while the doctrine doesn't change. Discipline changes a lot, right? It's the application, the perspective, the culture that influences that discipline or disposes the church to make the changes to accommodate that. Well, similarly, love, faith, and hope remain in the sense that love is perfected, hope is perfected, faith is perfected. In the imperfection of faith is gone. In that sense, it does not remain. The imperfect hope we had on earth is gone. In that sense, it doesn't remain. But in as much as they are consummated in God, faith, hope, and love, they remain in their essence. Why? Because once you're baptized for all eternity. And when you're baptized, you receive faith, hope, and love, and nothing can take them away. That's baptism, faith, hope, and love. The fruit of baptism cannot be taken away. It's indelible. So in heaven, we remain with faith, hope, and love, but in its perfected form. Analogously, one can say the same thing about the human body before and after the general judgment. Before the general judgment, it is an imperfect form. It has wrinkles, it has scars, whatever you want to call it. Imperfections, blemishes. And then after the general resurrection, it is perfect, but it's the same substantial body, having the same substantial gender. So if you are conceived as a male, you will be for all eternity in a male body. If you are conceived as a female, you'll be for all eternity in a female body. That's why the Blessed Mother always appears as a woman, even to this day. And Jesus always appears as a man, even to this day. That will never change. But the accidental properties of that body are perfected. So when Jesus appears, he does not appear as he did on the crucifix. His body is perfected. He still bears the wounds of slaughter in the hands, on the feet, in the side. This is reported in the book of Revelation. It says, John beheld in heaven a lamb with the marks of slaughter. But he doesn't bear all the appearances that he bore on the cross. The blood dripping down, all the gaping holes, the tattered flesh, that does not appear anymore. The only reason the five wounds appear is a testament that remains for all eternity for the love with which he shed his blood for mankind, thereby raising the human race above all other creatures in the past, present, future. That's a testament to all creation, not just us. Okay? So, whereas faith and hope are related to the attainment of the good as means to an end, and thus have a limited function, divine love possesses the good in its entirety and perfects faith and hope in the next life. So love is the supreme union in which faith and hope find their true goal. For love fulfills these by giving them rest from their movement toward their goal and brings from something to be, from hoping to be, the enjoyment of what is present. Okay. Now, I know I'm getting a little bit theological, but I wanted to introduce the reason for the Jubilee year and how it relates to Luisa and baptism, which we all receive, and the gift of living in the divine will, because we are living in sad times, times in which, as I mentioned, power is being abused by those who have it over us. But let us never lose sight of the fact that everything is under God's control. No one can move a muscle or take a breath without God's willing and permitting it. God is permitting all this for a very good reason. Okay. I want to share with you a few passages of Luisa where Jesus tells her that, I'll give you the date first, then I'll quote it to you, where he talks to her about having sure hope. It's from volume 4, October 10, 1900. She writes, "Who knows how much nonsense these writings contain? They deserve to be thrown into the fire. If obedience allowed it, I would do so. As my soul experiences such affliction, especially on account of the writings ending up in the hands of certain people. But since it is obedience that wants me to write, which is one of my greatest sacrifices, I commend myself completely to her with the sure hope that she will excuse what I write and justify my cause before God and man." So here Luisa links hope with obedience. She's has sure hope in obedience. So she writes, "Upon arriving, Blessed Jesus responded to my thought and said to me, 'Certainly these writings deserve to be consumed in the fire. But do you wish to know in which fire? In the fire of my love. As there is not one page that does not manifest in clear terms the depth of my love for souls through those events pertaining to you both, to both you and the world.'" Okay. Now, Luisa had this reluctance to write because she knew individuals that might read personal matters that transpired between her and our Lord, some of the things of which you already know from reading the volumes. And that will, of course, be a source of embarrassment to her because she would meet with these people, including priests, even the bishop, and so forth. She never tired of renewing this hope in obedience. And she clung to it blindly. This is something that our Lord exhorted her to do, especially in Volume 1. So Luisa is an example for all of us, in as much as she had to practice, like us, every day by renewing her morning offering, her rounds, her meditation on the Passion, and her actual acts, divine acts. The desire that the Lord wanted her to be set ablaze with by the exercise of hope, faith, and love. So Luisa had moments where she was crestfallen, despondent, and the Lord allowed her to go through these moments of trial and testing and the absence of his tangible, sensible presence, because only by this means, he tells her, was she able to redouble love, redo her past imperfect acts, and grow in virtue, the virtues especially of faith, hope, and love. So trials make hope grow. And this is something that is not preached often in the mainstream press. We'll never hear it, actually. But we find it in Luisa's writings from cover to cover. This constant exercise, discursive prayer and exercise of the virtues, whereby She grew every day, just like we do, in these theological virtues that were gifts at baptism and became virtues at the moment of exercise at the age of reason. We're called to do identically the same thing. Certainly, she arrived at a state of union higher than all of us, but the exercise of these virtues was exactly like the exercise we do every day of our lives. In that sense, she was cut from this, made from the same clay as us, made from the same cloth as us, from original sin, unlike the Blessed Mother. And she had to struggle just like us, internally and externally. So she gives us, from her own example, hope. And this is especially prevalent in Volume One. I see there's a hand raised. You can grab that question.
We was talking in one of our class meetings about the Immaculate Conception of our Blessed Mother, and Luisa said that our Lord told Luisa that by our Blessed Mother, what He is by nature, she is by grace.
Yes.
So she's full of love, and then when she says, "I am the Immaculate Conception," is that her saying that, or the Holy Spirit within her saying that? Because it's using "I am," like
Right.
God, it says "I am."
Sure, both. It's both. Same with the Magnificat. My soul magnifies the Lord, as she says, all generations will call me blessed. That's not a proud statement. It's patently honest, soberingly honest. You see, when a person acknowledges a truth with respect to God, another, or themselves, there's no pride in that. And what makes them say that is God. So in response, it's the Holy Spirit speaking in and through her with her consent. So they're both speaking, you see. And the reason the Blessed Mother said these things is not simply to tell people, God has blessed me, which is part of it, but principally for our good. You know, what did Jesus say in the gospel? I say this, thank you, Father, for having given me, for having given me all those, and none of them are lost except the one who was sent to perdition. Then he goes on and says, now is time for the Son of Man to be glorified. And then he goes on and says, I do not say this for me, but for you. So some things the Blessed Mother said for us. So when she said, I am the Immaculate Conception, why did she say that? Because just a few years earlier, at the First Vatican Council, it was declared as a dogma of faith under Pope Pius IX. And when she used that expression to Bernadette in French dialect, it was just a few years after that dogmatic statement was made known. But remember, back in the 1800s, there was no social media like today. So very few people knew of this dogmatic statement at the time, even though it was made a dogmatic statement, the church didn't catch on yet. So very few people knew of this. Therefore, when the Blessed Mother told Bernadette, she was surprised. And then when she told the priest, and then it went to the Pope, they were like, how did she know that? So she said it for a reason, and that was to confirm that she is truly the Mother of God, and that she obeys the church and works through the church and never used this expression until the church acknowledged it. Isn't that interesting? Mary never said for 2,000 years, I am the Immaculate Conception. Why? Because the church did not give her that title yet. This is how obedient Mary is. She wouldn't even say it in her apparitions before this. She waited for the church first to give her that title, then she made it public. Okay, thank you for the question.
I have two things. The first is just a statement that has been so comforting to me, and I thought I'd share it. It says, in the divine will, everything is safe. I just think that's awesome. And then my question is, I didn't get the information on the fallen angels from last week. If you could say that again, please.
Can you refresh my memory?
I think you said that there is no such thing as fallen angels.
No, no, I didn't say that.
That's why I wanted to double check, because I was talking to my friend and I said, you know, I've heard over the years that that's what happened. They fell. So,
yeah, I think you were probably tuning in to a heretical preacher. It wasn't me. You're
no,
mixing me up
you.
With someone else.
Thank
no,
you.
No, I in all my talks, I talk about how St. John the Evangelist spoke to Polycarp, and Polycarp communicated to Irenaeus that the reason why Lucifer fell with a third was because God revealed to him that he would assume not an angelic but a human nature. It's in all my talks, practically. Yeah, but thank you for that.
Right.
But going back to your first comment, you're referring to everything is safe. That comes from volume 17, January 4th, 1925, where Luisa relates that she was trying to fuse herself in the divine will, right? And then Jesus intervenes and then tells her, fusing yourself in my will is the most solemn act. And then shortly thereafter, he tells her that the angels, the saints, the divinity and self convey everything to the soul when it fuses itself in my will, knowing that what they convey is conveyed in God's will where everything is safe. That's the phrase you use, just giving you the context. Thank you. Next question.
I'm looking at volume 9, lower my hand, May 25th, 1909, and I just wanted help with the translation.
Sure.
It says, Jesus confounds the soul with love, and the word confounds I find to be unclear. Mm-hmm. So the second paragraph.
Can you repeat the date? May, is it
sure.
May, you said?
May 25th. 1909.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm trying to pump the Italian volumes here.
Continuing in my usual state, Blessed Jesus was not coming. However, for the whole day, I felt as if there were someone over me who would not let me waste 1 minute of time, but would keep me always in continuous prayer. A thought wanted to distract me by saying to me, when the Lord does not come, you pray more. You are more attentive, and by this, you yourself give him the field not to come, because the Lord may say, since she behaves better when I do not go, it is better if I deprive her of me. Since I could not waste time in listening to what my thought was saying, in order to shut the door on its face, that's kind of an odd, I said, the more he does not come, the more I will confound him with love. So the word confound him with love. I don't want to give him the occasion. This
overwhelm
is
him
I'm,
is the proper Italian word, overwhelm.
Overwhelmed. Okay, thank
mm-hmm.
you.
Yeah.
So that it will make more sense now. I probably
yeah.
don't need to continue reading. Okay, good. Overwhelmed.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
yeah, the English.
Yeah. Okay, overwhelmed. What does she mean? Did she really say in order to shut the door on its face?
No, this is a literary translation which you cannot do. For example, in English, I can say to you, I know it's like the back of my hand, this place so well. You can't translate that literally in another language because they don't use that expression, the back of your hand. To them, it means your mother smacking you across the face. So certain idiomatic expressions cannot be translated literally, and that's what that volume's doing. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. What
yes.
it should be translated as is not shut the door in my face, but interrupt me. Stop me in my tracks. Yeah.
Thank you, Father Iannuzzi. I'm in volume 18, and the date is October 1, 1925.
Okay.
And it's the fourth paragraph. The last couple of sentences. It starts out, so everything I did and suffered brings man to God. Now, one who lives in my will living in the center of my humanity, takes all the fruits of all that I did and suffered and enters the order of creation. And my will fulfills in her the full purpose for which she was created. Others then who do not live in my will find the means to be saved, but do not enjoy the fruits of creation and redemption. And my question is, I don't understand what the fruits of creation and redemption are. And I also don't understand what living in the center of my humanity means. Those who do not live in my will find the means to be saved, but do not enjoy all the fruits of creation and redemption.
Okay, yes, yes. That's correct. They do not enjoy all the fruits. They do all receive fruits, but not all of them.
I don't understand what the fruits are. And
apples and oranges.
I know that.
The fruits are, it's a spiritual term. For example, when you go to communion properly disposed, the church calls that fruitful reception of the Eucharist. Why does it use that word fruitful? Because there's a flowering of grace, a burgeoning of that germ seed that God sows within you at baptism, confirmation, that multiplies itself when you receive a sacrament. So fruitful means an outpouring of grace, an additional outpouring. So when it says they don't receive all, the key word is all, it means they receive some of the fruits, but not all. Why not all? Why not all the effects of this outpouring? Because only the gift of living in the divine will restores to the soul all the effects that redemption, creation, sanctification were intended to produce. Remember, creation's first intended effect was no death, was no sin, was no aging, was no pain, no childbearing. All these were the result of sin. So we went from plan A, creation, to plan B, creation, which led to redemption. So the fruits of redemption are received in half measure, quarter measure, three-quarter measure, full measure, according to our correspondence to God's grace and this gift of living in the divine will. So to receive all the fruits of redemption, one must live in God's divine will and all the fruits of sanctification and creation. Okay. There was another question I think you asked about what is the center, is that right?
Yes. What does this enters the living in the center of my humanity?
Yes. His humanity is the center of the universe. St. Paul refers to this when he says that all things were created for Christ, in Christ, and through Christ. In fact, when the priest elevates the paten after the consecration and the Eucharistic canon, he says, through him, with him, and in him. Right? Everything was made in view of Christ. He is the center of creation. Jesus tells this to Luisa too. He says, my humanity is the center of the universe, because all that exists draws its existence from Christ. In Greek, the Eastern Fathers call him the Pleroma, the king of the universe, the center of the universe, Pleroma. So when he says that he is the center of creation, and that we must enter within his humanity, the center of his humanity, that means that he, in order for us to impact all things, we must do it through him. He is the gate, the way that it now allows us to participate in all that which his humanity did. He also tells Luisa in other passages that whenever we live or do an act in the divine will, we are doing exactly what his humanity did. Or he is doing it in us. He is reenacting within us that which he did during his earthly life, whereby our acts become theandric or divine acts. They're no longer our human acts, assisted remotely by God's grace, but God's immediate acts within us. God's doing them within us with our consent. But this cannot happen unless we enter within his humanity, in the center of his humanity. Now, with respect to the word center, Luisa did not enter there until the age of 35, and November 16th, 1900. And that's evident in that fourth nuptial, where she took possession of Jesus' heart and entered the center. And Jesus said, from now on, don't exit from the center, from within my center. So we enter the divine will. They're like concentric rings. God oftentimes uses the sun, the sphere, as an example of his divinity and his uncreated light and life. He says the sun's above everything, sustains everything, gives, illuminates everything. And he says, when you live in the divine will, you're taken up within the sun. And using that example of the sun, the sphere, we can imagine entering is just within that outer circle, the outer sphere. But as we approach the center of the sun, we are approaching that center of the source of light and life, which is Christ, the humanity of Christ. So when we enter the divine will, we don't have to be perfected in the virtues. But once we enter the center, we do. That's why Luisa didn't get there until 35. So entering is easy, but remaining there and entering, arriving at the center, requires habitual acts. That's why Jesus said you can't just do it with one act. And exercise of the virtues, reception of the sacraments, good works in the body and spirit, corporal works of mercy, and so forth. Thank you. All right. We have five more.
Thank you, Father.
You're welcome. Where are you from? And I detect that Oxford accent.
Well, I'm from the Bronx. I grew up in the Bronx. Yeah.
Oh, not far from where I was. My dad came from Brooklyn.
I grew up in Parkchester,
okay.
Yeah.
There were...
Tremont Avenue and Castle Hill Road.
Okay. You want to give us the phone number too?
If you were going to talk to an abbot or an abbess of a contemplative community who never heard of the divine will, what would you tell them that they would have to do differently? What would you say to them?
Well, I wouldn't tell them to do anything different because they might be a little bit taken aback, you know, but I would simply introduce it to them as something that the church has sanctioned as authentic. And you could show the nuns the seals of approval of the Magisterium on the Hours of the Passion, the Blessed Virgin Mary in the Kingdom of the Divine Will book. You could even show them other works that have these approvals, or works that are sanctioned by the church, like my dissertation, or works that are sanctioned by bishops, that are, you know, Splendor of Creation and so forth. But emphasize that this is a work of spiritual growth, because that's what the nuns are supposed to be specialists in. Spirituality, their vocation is to grow in holiness and to pray for the sanctification of the priests and for the world. So they should express interest if you approach them that way. But if you tell them that they're doing something wrong or should redo something this way, they might be a little bit, you know, a little bit shaken. Or you can just, you know, cut through the small talk and say, look here, you've got it all wrong. You know, let me teach you how to pray. see how that goes. I don't know.
Well, I meant if they thought that they were all, but I didn't mean any of that as far as negativity, but if they said something like, well, I feel I'm already doing that. I mean, you know, what could we say? Or what, I mean, I'm not saying anything to any, I mean, I'm a pretty silent person. I don't talk to that many people, but knowing abbots and abbesses, and I know monks and nuns, sometimes I think of them when I'm reading Luisa, because they are keeping silence and they are already at a very high level of sacrifice. But what would you say to them that is different? Be fruitful.
Sure.
If they think they're already doing this.
Right. Well, to try to explain it to them one-on-one might not be very easy. So you could either present them with a work that does that for them, but nothing too heavy, because they may not have the time to delve into it. Some may, but something that summarizes, you know, the novelty and the extraordinary outpouring of graces that accompany these writings and those who receive them. So one of the elements I would emphasize, for example, is the restoration of the primordial holiness that our first parents enjoyed. And if they don't understand what that means, which they probably won't, then you can explain very simply how the holiness of Adam and Eve that was forfeited with original sin is being outpoured in these end times and reserved for these end times. And that this is a gift, nothing that we can achieve through human effort only. The virtues dispose us to receive this gift, but the virtues do not obtain it. So it is freely given. Therefore, it cannot be acquired by prayers all day long. Certainly the prayers dispose us more and more to receive it, but we have to know of the gift in order to receive the gift. And once we do, that gift yields an abundance of fruits. For example, transtemporal activity. They may not have ever heard this, but it is the ability to influence all souls of the past, present, future in the present. The ability to offer infinite reparation to Jesus and to the Immaculate Heart of Mary, things that were asked by our Lord to St. Margaret Mary and by Our Lady to the three shepherd children of Fatima. And we're able to, this is something, it's not like a personal reward, it's a universal reward. It helps increase the glory of all creation. And remember, this is a new theology. Not new in the sense that it departs from theology of 2,000 years, but it explicates it to a new level. So it's not something they're going to get right away. Because it's like me telling you, I'll use an off-the-cuff example, that the universe is teeming with sentient beings that have bodies and spirits. Like, wait a minute. How do I fit this into my paradigm that I've been taught in school of sacramentology, of angels and humans as the only beings existing? Just an example, all right? Now, it takes time to put all these pieces together. You're not just going to figure it out in one sitting, right? Same thing with the divine will, because it's so groundbreaking and it's so revolutionary that you have to really allow the brain to create a space to compartmentalize it and connect to all the other things you learned in life. That takes time. So you want to feed them little by little, not throw them everything at once. And I would therefore give them something like a simple manual, a book. There's a download, free download on my website, How to Instruct Others How to Live in the Divine Will. It's 11 pages only. It talks about public revelation and private revelation. Then it talks about the writings of Luisa, the difference between her life, her spirituality, her writings, and her doctrine. Then it talks about her doctrine and how this is an outpouring of the Holy Spirit anticipated by saints. Pope John Paul II, John XXIII, referred to this as a second Pentecost, reserved for these end times. And Don Bosco foresaw this time. Louis de Montfort foresaw this. And yeah, but or if you want, you can just hand them The Splendor of Creation book, endorsed by two bishops, one's an archbishop, that talks about what I'm telling you now, that the early church fathers foresaw this outpouring. So did Augustine. So did Cyril of Jerusalem. So did Bernard of Clairvaux. They could relate to these because they're sound traditional pillars of the church. And then I talk about John the 23rd, Pope John the 23rd, John the 2nd, another early ecclesiastical writer is talking about this seventh day rest, the Sabbath rest, the third Christian millennium, the seventh millennium Christianity. I'm sorry, of the creation of Adam and Eve. They were created 6,000 years ago, right? So this is all connecting the dots. That doesn't happen overnight, but the splendor of creation does that. And it shows how these gifts and their characteristics are found in Luisa's writings and sanctioned by the church are identifiable therein. Okay, I guess that's it for now. All right, so thank you all. I'll ask you to say goodbye. You can throw eggs in empty cans if you want. Remember the Blues Brothers? Never mind.
Thank you, Father.
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 You're welcome. May God bless you and keep you always.
Father, thank you so much.
In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.